Hi, friends. My name is Matthew Dowling, preaching minister for the Plymouth Church of Christ, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to this online Bible study together, coming to you from my home study, and we're looking at the Holy Spirit seminar together. Today's lesson is lesson 22 of the Holy Spirit seminar, and we have been for many weeks now thinking about the Holy Spirit. I hope that this study has been helpful to you. And the reason why we have spent that much time on the Holy Spirit is often the Holy Spirit is not well understood by people. Today's lesson is called The Holy Spirit You Can Count On. And I want to begin with a story today that'll get us into our study time together. Back in the 1990s, the police department in Joplin, Missouri came up with an interesting plan. They didn't have enough officers to patrol all of the high-traffic intersections in their town. And so they would set up a patrol car on the side of the road, and they put a mannequin in the driver's seat, complete with a police uniform. And even though word got around town fast that this was not a real patrol officer, people would still slow down when they saw that car sitting in the intersection. Imitation, but effective. Well, another strange thing I've noticed is that some of the newer stores and malls with small ponds out in front of them will put fake swans or other birds in them that are very realistic. In fact, it's not uncommon to find people taking pictures of these birds thinking that they're going to have photographs of real birds. The point of these stories is you and I are fooled easily by imitations, aren't we? Both in our everyday experience as well as in our spiritual lives. Well, I would contend that many of us view the Holy Spirit like we view that police officer, that mannequin, or the fake swans. We read about the Holy Spirit in the Bible, and in some sense we believe that He is present in our lives, but at the same time, He doesn't seem quite real to us. In fact, I would have to say from personal experience that if there is one factor that is missing in many Christian lives, it is an awareness of and a deep relationship with the Holy Spirit of God. And the fact is, dear friends, if we are going to use the spiritual gifts that God has given us, and this is where we're going in these last lessons in the seminar together, if we're going to use these spiritual gifts that God has given us, we have to first have a good idea of just who the Spirit is, which is our focus in today's study. Now, this is in some ways going to be a review, but I want it to be a helpful one for you as you think about what you know about the Holy Spirit. And the first thing I want to make note of is the Holy Spirit is God, the triune God of the universe. Now, don't get scared. I'm not trying to get overly theological on you, but you do need to understand that the Holy Spirit is God. Just as much as the Father is God and Jesus is God, they are all three God, working together as the Godhead, the Trinity. And they each have different roles to play, but they are all God. And so when we talk about the Spirit, we are not just talking about God in spirit form, we're actually talking about God, the Holy Spirit, as an individual member of the Godhead. And the Holy Spirit is completely and fully God. There's nothing about God the Father or God the Son that is not also true about Him in that respect. And I'd like to invite you to take out your Bibles, if you have them, and do a little looking up with me some scripture, and let's look at a few passages of scripture together where we see the qualities of God attributed to the Holy Spirit, okay? And so the first passage I want to ask you to turn to is Hebrews 9, verse 14. Go ahead and turn there, I'll wait for you. Hebrews 9, verse 14. And Hebrews 9, verse 14 says this. Says, just think how much more the blood of Christ will purify our hearts from deeds that lead to death so that we can worship the living God. And then notice, for by the power of the eternal Spirit, Christ offered himself to God as a perfect sacrifice for our sins. That's Hebrews 9:14, which tells us the Spirit, did you catch it, is eternal. There's only one eternal being, that's the God of heaven and earth, of which the Holy Spirit is a divine person. Okay, so the Spirit is eternal just like God is. Okay, next passage I want to ask you to turn to is 1 Corinthians 2, verse 11. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 11, which says this, "For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God." What 1 Corinthians 2 verse 11 tells us is that the Spirit knows all things. This is, again, not to get too theological, but this is a quality of God known as omniscience, the all-knowing God. And the Spirit is one who knows all things, the things of God. And so, just like God, the Spirit knows all things. All right. Turn in your Bibles now to Luke 1 verse 35. Luke 1, verse 35. This is a story in Luke's gospel where the angel is visiting Mary to tell her that she's going to bear a baby, a child, the Messiah. Luke 1, verse 35 says, "The angel replied, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby born to you will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God.'" So here, if you notice, the angel is talking about how this will come to pass. It is that the Holy Spirit will come over Mary, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and the baby born will be holy and will be called the Son of God. This is one of many passages which describe the power of the Spirit, the godlike power of the Spirit, and we know that this and other passages points to the quality, again, not too theological, sorry, of omnipotence, all-powerfulness. And the Spirit is all-powerful. The Spirit is God. So omniscience, omnipotence, all wisdom, all power. And then we're left with one other, which is omnipresence. But let's go to the Old Testament to see this one. Just one of many places we could look. Turn to Psalm 139, verses 7 through 8. Psalm 139, verses 7 through 8. David asks there, he says, "Where can I go from your spirit, Lord? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there too." We could keep on reading there, but we'll stop. This tells us that the Spirit is all places at all times. Why? Because the Spirit is God. He has omnipresence. He's everywhere present. And then, of course, we know in the Bible that the Spirit is addressed as God. You can turn to Acts chapter 5, verses 3 and 4 to see an example of this. Acts 5, verses 3 through 4. There it says, "Then Peter said, 'Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart? You lied to the Holy Spirit, and you kept some of the money for yourself. The property was yours to sell or not to sell as you wished, and after selling it, the money was yours to give away. How could you do a thing like this? You weren't lying to us, but to God.'" Okay, and notice here, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is addressed as God. So we know that the Spirit is God, the Spirit's eternal, the Spirit knows all things, he's all powerful, he's all places at all times, and straight up, the Bible refers to the Holy Spirit as God. Now, I could give you many more passages to demonstrate that the Holy Spirit is presented to us in the Bible as holy and completely God, but I think that's enough for now, okay? Other places in the Bible, he's referred to as the Spirit of truth, the Spirit of grace, the Spirit of wisdom. Here's the thing. The point I'm trying to get across is that when we talk about the Holy Spirit, we're not talking about a ghost or an it. We're talking about the very person of God himself. So the respect and honor that we give to the Father and the Son should also be given to the Spirit of God. This is very important. The Holy Spirit is part of the Trinity. He is God. Okay, Let's absorb that for just a second. The Holy Spirit is God. The Bible tells us that. This is the Spirit we can count on. Now, let's move to a second point in our lesson together today, and that is that the Holy Spirit is not only God. The Holy Spirit is unique. The Holy Spirit is unique. What do I mean by that? Well, when we say something or someone is unique, we are saying there is something about them that makes them stand apart from the crowd, okay? For example, there are many women in the world, but my wife is unique in that she is the only one that is married to me. Whether that's bad or good, I'll let you decide, but it definitely makes Rachel unique. So here's the thing. While the Holy Spirit is God, in the same way the Son and the Father are God, He plays a unique role in the, again, not to get too theological, but He plays a unique role in the triune Godhead, okay? And here's the thing. I'm going to say something to you. I want you to listen closely, and I want you to track the truth of this, all right? The Father is God. The Son is God. The Spirit is God. Those things are all true. But these things are also true. The Father is not the Spirit. The Spirit is not the Son. The Son is not the Father. And yet all of them are God. Now, I want you to notice what I just said. The Father is God, the Son is God, the Spirit is God, and yet, when you hear what I also said, you'll see that the Son is not the Father, the Father's not the Spirit, the Spirit's not the Son, and yet they are all equally God. They each have a completely unique function. And here's the thing. While you don't have to be an expert on the Trinity, it would be great if you could remember this one basic truth, okay? The Holy Spirit ministers to you and to the world at large in a different way than do the Father or the Son. Now let's stop there and ask, are you confused yet? I hope not. I bet you're not. In fact, I'm hoping this is becoming clearer, okay? And let me give you a couple of passages that tell us all three members of the Godhead and their unique roles, all right? So if you have your Bibles again, grab them. And turn to Mark chapter 1, verses 10 through 11. Mark chapter 1, verses 10 through 11. Mark 1, 10 through 11 says this, that when Jesus came up out of the water, this is at Jesus' baptism, it says he saw the heavens split open and the Holy Spirit descending like a dove on him. And it says a voice came from heaven saying, You are my Son, and I am fully pleased with you. So here we have Jesus. He's coming up out of the waters. We have the Holy Spirit descending something like a dove upon Jesus, and a voice from heaven saying, You're my beloved Son, and I'm fully pleased with you. This is the Father, okay? So we see each of them uniquely present, and yet they are all the one God. Turn over to John 14, verse 26. John 14, verse 26, and we're going to do kind of the same thing we just did with this passage about Jesus' baptism, all right? John 14, verse 26 says, But when the Father sends the Counselor as my representative, this is Jesus saying these words, says, But when the Father sends the Counselor as my representative, and by the Counselor, I mean the Holy Spirit. He will teach you everything and will remind you of everything I myself have told you. So here's Jesus talking about the Godhead. He mentions the Father, who's going to send the Counselor as my representative. And the text in this translation goes on to unpack it by saying the Counselor, he means the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will teach the disciples everything and remind them of everything I myself have told you. So see, we have all three of the persons of the Godhead present in this text. Now, I could show you any number of verses to prove this point, but the idea is that they each member of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they function in different ways, okay? And we need to know that the Holy Spirit's function to humanity is really, 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 really important to each one of us. In particular, this is very important, in particular, it is the Holy Spirit's job to lead people to faith in Jesus and the one who gives them the ability to lead a Christian life. So if you're listening to me right now and you're a Christian, you need to thank God for that. Thank God for the Holy Spirit for regenerating your heart. Also, thank God for the Spirit which sanctifies your life, okay? And so that's a unique function of the Holy Spirit. Praise God for it. Now, not the only things that the Holy Spirit does. In fact, I'd like to spend a couple of moments looking at some other specific roles of the Spirit who deals with us, okay? Maybe I'll just run through these kind of quickly. You can just listen. Feel free to turn there, but I'm not going to kind of go slow, so you better be really nimble with those fingers. First passage is Ephesians 3, verses 4 through 5. And what we're going to learn here is that the Spirit reveals the mind of God. Paul writes there, "As you read what I've written, you will understand what I know about this plan regarding Christ." He says, "God did not reveal this plan, it, to previous generations, but now he has revealed it by the Holy Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets." So the Spirit was behind the revelation of the mind of God to the holy apostles and prophets. And so one of the roles of the Spirit is to reveal the mind of God. He's an agent in revelation. So if you have your copy of the good book, the Bible, you have that because the Holy Spirit has helped reveal this masterful text to us. That's why it's the book of books. It's divinely authored and inspired. Okay, turn to John 3, verses 5 through 6. John 3, 5 through 6, where we learn that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, gives us the means to be born again. There it says, "The truth is, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives new life from heaven." So the Spirit is the agent which causes human beings to be born again and to become Christians, Spirit-filled people. This time we're going to hear from Ephesians 2, verse 18, where we're going to learn another function of the Spirit is the Spirit allows us to approach the Father. Paul writes there, he says, "Now all of us, both Jews and Gentiles, may come to the Father through the same Holy Spirit because of what Christ has done for us." And so the Spirit allows us to approach the Father. Very important thing. Every time we pray, we can be thankful for that. And then finally, not certainly exhaustively, but another thing is the Spirit teaches the truth of God. Listen to 1 Corinthians 2, verses 11 and 12. Paul writes, "No one can know what anyone else is really thinking except that person alone, and no one can know God's thoughts except God's own Spirit. And, listen, God has actually given us his Spirit, not the world's Spirit, so we can know the wonderful things that God has freely given us." What are we being told here about the role of the Spirit? We're being told that the Spirit teaches the truth of God. The truth of God. Excuse me. Now, there are many more things I could say to you about the unique role of the Spirit, and we'll be looking at those in more depth in the next couple of lessons. But for now, just remember that the Holy Spirit has a unique role in your life and in the world. So the Holy Spirit is God, and the Holy Spirit has a very unique role. Okay? And then now the last part of our lesson about the Holy Spirit is that the Holy Spirit is within you, is within you. Let me tell you a story just to kind of get us back on board. We've been throwing a lot of scripture and little theology in our minds. And I want to give you a chance to get back on the train car here. One of the more humorous quirks of scientific history is the debate over who should get credit for discovering oxygen, you know, this stuff that we breathe quite a bit. The first contender is Joseph Priestley. He's an English scientist and was a clergy person. He was a minister. And he's often given that honor because he was the first to publish his findings in 1774. Now, interestingly, Joseph Priestley originally called oxygen gas dephlogisticated air. Aren't you glad that you don't have to call it that? But here's where the debate comes in. In 1772, so for those counting, that's 2 years prior to Joseph Priestley's find, there was a Swedish chemist named Carl Scheele. I think I'm probably mispronouncing that. It's S-C-H-E-E-L-E. Scheele. Who independently discovered the gas that is vital to our existence. Now, strangely enough, the term oxygen didn't actually come into use until 1775, when yet another chemist, this time a French guy named Antoine Lavoisier, he discovered and named the gas that we breathe. And so Lavoisier was the first to recognize oxygen as one of the natural elements in the atmosphere. And really, frankly, regardless of who gets the credit, it's odd to think of a human being discovering oxygen. I mean, does a fish discover water? The truth is that oxygen literally surrounds us every day. And even if we choose to call it dephlogisticated air, the fact is we can't live without it. And here's the thing. The same is true of the Holy Spirit, dear friend. He is here. He is real. He has promised to every person who places their trust in Jesus Christ. And whether you've recognized his work in your life up to this point or not is irrelevant. He is a very necessary part of you leading a Christian life. That's why when Peter said in Acts 2:38, when asked, "What must I do to be saved?" Peter replied this way. He said, "Each of you must turn from your sins, repent, and turn to God, and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Now, the gift of the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit himself. And as we've already seen, the Holy Spirit is fully and completely God. So, if the Holy Spirit lives in you, that means God lives in you. All right, that's tremendous. That's why Paul said in 1 Corinthians 3, verse 16, "Don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God lives in you?" Do you know that, dear friend, about yourself? The Spirit of God lives in you. That's why 1 John 3, verse 24, John writes, "Those who obey God's commands live in fellowship with him, and he with us. And we know he lives in us because the Holy Spirit lives in us." And you know, dear friends, now knowing that God literally lives within us should cause us to make some radical changes in our lives. My friend, if God lives within me, then I have the power to overcome every single temptation ever thrown at me. Will you have that power right now? And not only that, if God lives within you, then you have the ability to love others in the same way that God loves them. You can do that because the Spirit is with you. And not only that, if God lives within you, then you have no excuses when it comes to living the way he wants you to live your life. If God lives within you, there's absolutely nothing that can stop you from becoming the dad or the mom or the husband or the child or the employee or the employer that he wants you to become. In fact, if God lives within me, there are no limits to what I can become or what I can overcome or what I can accomplish in life, because I have come to realize that the same God who created the universe, the same God who parted the Red Sea, the same God who showed compassion for those in need is the same God who has promised to live within me. And with that kind of presence as part of my life, I've got to come to the realization that Paul was not kidding when he said this. He said, I pray that from God's glorious, unlimited resources, he will give you mighty inner strength through his Holy Spirit. That's Ephesians 3:16. My friends, with God's Spirit within us, we have the power to see and to be and to do and to say and to learn and to accomplish anything God wants us to. It really comes down to a matter of trusting in him and leaning on his power to not only see us through, but to help us to live lives of righteousness, righteous surrender to Jesus Christ. So my prayer for you this week is that the Holy Spirit would be real to you, that he would be as real as the nose on the end of your face, and that you would understand the Spirit and you would understand the Spirit's power in your life. My prayer is that you will be able to do just that this week. Thank you for joining me for another episode of the Holy Spirit Seminar. This has been lesson 22, I believe. I might even be losing count. There's been so many. But I've really appreciated you joining me on this journey. And may God bless you this week, dear friends. Goodbye for now.